So, in the last, say, 30 years, there has been a great progress in our understanding of phase transition, thanks to to field theory, to the methods of field theory, and to the normalization group. So, if there is a name which comes to mind, is the name of Ken Wilson, who was really made the most important contribution in the field. So I think one of the biggest successes of this theory was the understanding of universality. Of course, with you can compute critical exponents and other properties near the phase transition, but my point of view, understanding of universality was really a big achievement. Universality, I will explain what universality is. Universality was known before the normalization group. For example, if you take Ising spins, you know, spins which are aligned in one direction because of anisotropies in the material. In some materials, the spins can be aligned only in one direction, and there are very different materials, different lattices. So all of them have the same critical exponents. So we say that they belong to the same universality class. Another example is Heisenberg spins, again, of different lattices and different, so they belong to another universality class, and we understand why they belong to the same universality class or why they are in a different universality class. Another example is the liquid to vapor transition in different liquids. Again, they belong to the same universality class. Now, I'm coming to the, I will give a few examples of systems with quench disorder. So, spin glass is such a system. So, this is the famous Edwards Anderson Hamiltonian, which models, we model the spin glasses. So, spin glasses are the positions, say, of the magnetic ions in the materials are random, but because the interaction depends on the distance, we get random interaction, strength of interaction, because the positions are random. So we cannot model the randomness of the position, but so the model is to consider, for example, an irregular lattice, for example, and consider that the couplings, you have nearest neighbors couplings, and that the couplings are random variables. And we say it's quenched because if you study a system, the interaction terms are fixed, they don't move in time, while the spins can flip. So, in this case, for the random field model, so this is a theoretical model, does not exist, this material does not exist in nature. We have a Hamiltonian which is ferromagnetic, and at every side we have an external field which is considered as being a random variable, quenched, does not move with time. So there are other materials which exist in nature, which are diluted antiferromagnet, and then you apply an external magnetic field. Finally, maybe very briefly, I mentioned the ferromagnetic pot model. Now, this diluted antiferromagnet in an external magnetic field are believed to belong to the same universality class as the random field. So this is the experimental realization, if you want. But okay, this is a theoretical belief which may be true, maybe not true. I don't know. We'll see about that. Okay, here. Now, in this model, because, for example, the random field, we have a different field on its side, or in the spin glasses the coupling constants are different at different parts of the system, we don't have translation invariance in the system. So we don't, in fact, we don't even know the exact form of the Hamiltonians. We know that it belongs to a certain family, okay? But we don't know which is the. So we cannot apply field theory under those conditions. And so if we want to study the phase transition. So theorists have invented a trick which is called the replicas. So in order to treat those systems, what are the replicas? You consider identical copies of your system, not interacting with each other. So you see the Hamiltonian is just the sum of the different copies. And now consider the average. So we have this replicated Hamiltonian, replicated because there is the sum over the copies over there. So there are n of them. And we say sum of the disorder. What does it mean, sum of the disorder? It means we are summing the distribution of the external random fields. And we compute the two-point correlation function here. Okay? Now, you see that if we are summing over, there is one particular here, a copy of the system, the copy alpha, which is present there. So for the other copies, we get the partition function. Okay? And how many copies are there except for this one? The total number of copies are n, so we get the partition function to the power n minus 1. And then you get this copy here with the corresponding Hamiltonian. Okay, now you see this z to the power n minus 1 in the limit n goes to 0 becomes 1 over z. So you see in the limit n goes to 0, this becomes the average of the two-point correlation function over the disorder. So you see here, we could not apply average over the disorder to the two-point correlation function directly because we have 1 over the partition function, and the partition function depends on the disorder in a very complicated way. And the usefulness of this trick, that we can make the average, and so we obtain, by doing the average, we obtain an effective Hamiltonian. Here, for example, I will write it down for the random field model. So you see the first terms are the non-interacting terms of a single copy, of a single replica, but the effect of averaging over the disorder produces an additional term, which is this one, which couples the different replicas. So the different replicas at the beginning, before doing the average over the disorder, were not coupled, independent each other, but the effect of averaging over the disorder produces a coupling between replicas. And this is the example for the random field model. Of course, you get different effective Hamiltonians for the other models. So, from what we said, we could compute this. I'm showing the previous you see here this it produces an effective Hamiltonian, which is this here. So we can use this formula to find what is the average of the two-point function, so in the random field model, average over all the disorder. Okay. What did we have gain by doing this? What we have gained, that this effective Hamiltonian in the replica space here is translation invariant. And it's like, it looks like a good field theory, and we can apply all the methods we know in the normalization group to this effective Hamiltonian. That's the usefulness of this replica trick. This effective Hamiltonian is translation invariant and has only the good properties of a good Hamiltonian, except for this strange limit that we have to take n goes to zero at the end. So, if we believe that, now we can apply perturbative normalization group and compute critical exponents and derive universality classes in the usual way, as we have done before, and believe that this remains valid in the limit n goes to zero. So, if you do that, you will find, for example, that diluted antiferromagnet with different dilutions, because you can dilute, you can prepare your samples with different dilutions, or you can apply different values of magnetic external fields. So, this theory tells you that all those systems belong to the same universality class. Okay, that's one of the conclusion you reach. But there is a problem. The problem is that experiments do not agree with this statement. And there have been very big fights between different experimental groups saying my result is correct, yours is not, and so on. Because everybody, I mean, Fermi believed that they are in the same universality class. So, since that time, so the majority, say, of the theorists took the easy attitude, say, that those experiments are not relevant. Why they are not relevant? Because all those disorder systems, this is true for the random field systems, this is true also for the spin glasses, have very slow dynamics, and they are not easy to equilibrate. So the general attitude has said that, so people have failed to equilibrate, so the results are non-meaningful, are irrelevant. Okay, that's the general attitude of the theorist. So this is an experimental problem. This is not a theoretical problem. Okay? Okay. Now I'm coming back in field theory. So you know that, for example, in the two-point correlation functions, so decay exponentially with distance, which I have done there. So m is the correlation length. It's called the 1 over m is the correlation length, or is the mass in the replica Hamiltonian. So in the replica formula, so this is the average of the two-point function with respect to the disorder. In the replica formalism, you can compute also the average of the square of the correlation function here, and is given this with, or say, here, yes, is sum over the spins with these replicas. And what you find, so that the two-point function, the average of the two-point function decays in this way, where m is the mass which appears in the replicated theory, and if you take the average of the square, of course it decays again exponentially with a different mass, but this different mass is 2 times the mass appearing here, and this is valid in all orders of perturbation theory. Okay, maybe this is a little bit theoretical here. So say the reason is, if you try to write the diagram, the field theory diagrams, the replica indices, there is symmetry which conserve the replica symmetry, the replica indices, and what you find that in all orders of perturbation theory, the correlation length is well defined. That is self-averaging. You know, I should say what means self-averaging. So maybe we consider an ensemble of systems which cause our disorder. So there are many realizations. Self-averaging means that the infinite, so if we do self-average into one quantity, means that if you measure this quantity in the different systems, we'll find the distribution, the width of the distribution goes to zero when the volume goes to infinity. The mathematicians have another expression with physicists talk about self-averaging. Mathematicians say there is concentration of the measure. The measure is the probability measure, and I think this is more correct. I mean, you have a probability distribution, so for the values for every copy of your system, and when you take the volume going, increase the volume, so this measure, probability measure, becomes narrow, concentrated around the average. Now we have made an hypothesis that we can describe the system with the replica Hamiltonian, and that we can apply the normalization, perturbative normalization group. In fact, there is a hidden assumption when you do that. You don't say the assumption explicitly, that there exists a single mass scale in the problem, which is well defined, which means if you measure it, there is a concentration of the measure for this quantity. In fact, there have been indications that this may be not true. And the earliest indication is due to Mehran Kardar from MIT in 87, who studied the interfaces in random media in 2 dimensions using replicas. And in this case, you know, it turns for one-dimensional quantum systems or for two-dimensional classical systems, there exists a method to find an exact solution, which is called the Bethe-Ansatz. So Kardar used this method, the Bethe-Ansatz, and he showed that the effective interaction between a replica is attractive, and that there exists a bound state between replicas. And so this means that there exists a new length scale to the problem, which is the mass of the bound state. So this, the formation of bound states, is a non-perturbative effect, so they cannot be seen in perturbation theory. So the general attitude of the community has been to ignore this result. And so, because of course, I mean, you do better answers, you do in Hamiltonian, you have n copies, so there is, those copies are fictitious, it's just an artifact, a technical artifact. Okay, there is no something corresponding to the reality. And at the end, you take, then goes to zero limit. And in fact, they become bound states when n becomes smaller than 1. Because for this reason, people have the tendency to ignore, say this is a pathology of the replicas with Bethe-Ansatz. So more recently, we have studied the correlation functions in the three dimensions random field easing model numerically. And also, yes, I should say here, I mean, I apologize, I have not written who we are. So, except for the both cases, is Giorgio Parisi, who was also collaborating with Giorgio Parisi from Rome, and for the random pots, also Marco Pico, who is also in Paris. So the three of us. So this was very large. There were very large numerical simulations, and what we found. So, in three dimensions, if I remember correctly, we have something 256 to the cube, so pretty large. And for the POTS model, 512 squares, because the POTS, random POTS model was in two dimensions, and the easy model was in three dimensions. And in both cases, we found this. If we take the average of the square of the correlation function, you can write it, you can decompose that this is equal, there is a constant here, C1, which is equal to the average, and a second constant, C2, which is the square of the average. So, because the square of the average decays faster, so the average decays exponentially, and the other, so exponentially again, but twice as fast. This means for very large distances, the two quantities behave the same way, which is a surprising result. And no, so you see there are two coefficients here, C1 and C2. So this is C1. Plotted, those are the results of the numerical simulation. You know, you have to make, in order to be able to extrapolate to the infinite volume limit, of course those are finite volumes, you must plot in terms of dimensionless quantities, as people do usually. So you see the L is the length of the system, and M is one of the correlation lengths, so this is a dimensionless quantity. The phase transition is at M equal zero. Here is the critical point, and you see that if you are far away for the phase transition, C1 is zero. But it's different from zero if you are near the phase transition. Okay, I'm coming back. So C1 is, I have not plotted, this is equal to C2, which means that you have self-averaging if you are away from the critical point, but if you are coming back, coming close to the critical point, and here it gets one, which is the maximum violation, possible violation of self-averaging for the mass. And so those are analogous results for the random ferromagnetic POTS model in three dimensions. You see, L goes up to 500 here. Here I did not write the lattice. Okay? So the violation is smaller here. So let's say there are two simulations. One is for the random field, and the other one is for the random POTS model. For the random POTS model, the exact critical temperature is known because it is self-dual.